Lay down a list of what is wrong. Things you told them all along. Pray to God he hears you. And pray to God he hears you. And where did I go wrong? I lost a friend somewhere along in the bitterness.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Backfired, an NBA history podcast about bad teams, bad luck, and bad decisions. My name is Lewis, and today we're going to talk about a near-death experience that Tom Gugliotta, a forward for the Phoenix Suns, had back in 1999 after taking a substance that was marketed as a sleep aid but turned out to be something far more sinister. Gugliotta, also known as Googs, is just randomly one of my favorite, like, 90s to early 2000s NBA players. And I think it's because one of the first games that I watched that he was playing in within the last couple of years, I was watching the Vancouver Grizzlies, of course, their first ever home game back in 1995, which was a super exciting victory by the Grizzlies over the Minnesota Timberwolves. Awesome buzzer beating tip in overtime by a guy named Chris King. Definitely worth searching up on YouTube, but Googs was playing for the Wolves at the time, and Christian Laettner was also on the team and often on the court at the same time. So I probably was just like, okay, this is the evil white guy and this is the good one. And that just permeated in my brain. So before I get into it, I'm going to try having this be a Thursday show instead of Wednesday for a few weeks and just see how that works out with my schedule. Doing the recording on Tuesday night and posting it on Wednesday used to work really well for me 14 weeks ago, and now it doesn't quite anymore. So I'm going to try that out for a little bit and see how it goes. And, you know, you're still going to get an episode every week, just a day later. Now, you know, I know there are thousands of you typing up your strongly worded emails right now, but you know what? I cannot read. Anyway, let's get into it. So Googs went to North Carolina State. He got to play two seasons for Jimmy V, Jim Valvano, and then played another two for Les Robinson after Jimmy V left. He played in the NBA from the 1993 season through the 2005 season. He was a one-time All-Star, selected sixth overall by the Washington Bullets in 1992, played there for two full seasons, and then right after the beginning of his third season in Washington, he was sent to the Golden State Warriors to get Chris Webber in return. And Webber had forced his way off of the Warriors after just one season due to a conflict with head coach Don Nelson. And then just 3 months after he was acquired by Golden State, Gugliotta was traded once again to the Minnesota Timberwolves, where he and Kevin Garnett were a really good 1-2 punch at the two forward spots for a couple of years there. And just to give you an idea of the caliber of player that Googs was, here are his stats from his All-Star season. So he had 20.5 points, just under 9 rebounds, 4 assists, a steal and a half, and a block per game. You know, good assist numbers for a guy who plays a lot of power forward, but, you know, he also had 3.5 turnovers per game as well, so not a good assist to turnover ratio. He shot about the same amount of long twos as he took shots at the rim and was pretty efficient from both of those spots, but was not a good three-point shooter. So, you know, he was solid, but he had some flaws. And one flaw that he had, clearly, was that he was allergic to the bag. He notably left about $26 million on the table to leave the Minnesota Timberwolves for the Phoenix Suns in free agency after the lockout in 1999. And that was in part due to how sick and tired he was of hearing the Wolves starting point guard Stephon Marbury talk about how much he wanted to be, you know, a Knick, or at least back in New York, how annoying it was that Kevin Garnett was the star, the highest paid player on the team, all that stuff. And there's a New York Post article that I found that is so candid and just absolutely hilarious. One of the reasons that I love reading articles from, like, before social media and especially before the year 2000 is that some guys will just say absolutely anything on the record, let the papers post it with no qualms, no follow-up, anything like that. So in this article, Gugliotta is just like, Marbury sucks. I hate this guy so much. So Googs had been playing for Phoenix for parts of two seasons at this point. So we're going to jump in on the Suns on December 17th, 1999. So the Suns were 15-7, and they had just gotten a new head coach who was Scott Skiles just days beforehand because Danny Ainge had stepped down as the Suns head coach. And this was completely out of nowhere for most people. It was super abrupt. And there were a bunch of rumors flying around at the time that either Jerry Colangelo had forced him out or that Ainge was frustrated with the way that the Suns were playing, and that was something that Jason Kidd felt was the real reason. Or that Scott Skiles, who was the lead assistant, had done a move that I like to call the JB Bickerstaff, because Bickerstaff has done this three times, where you go behind the head coach's back and undermine him, and then he gets fired or has to step down and you become the head coach. But Ainge maintains that one of his teenage sons complained to him that he was becoming too distant, and he and his siblings wanted Danny to be at home more. Ainge had been missing holidays and major milestones, especially in his younger children's lives, that made him realize that at this moment, his family needed him more than the sons did. He said, quote, "I love coaching, but anybody can coach. My wife has just one husband, and my children have just one father. Some of you may think I'm jumping ship, but I'm diving overboard to save my family." But regardless, the Suns hadn't skipped a beat so far in the transition to playing under Skiles. They were 2-0 under Skiles, who was described in the Arizona Republic as, quote, "the bad cop to Ainge's good cop." And he was a super intense guy, definitely a badass. This guy, Scott Skiles, went to jail multiple times when he was in college at Michigan State for like various things, including cocaine possession at one point. Still got drafted in the first round, which is crazy to me. So on the night of the 17th, the Suns won a road game against the Portland Trail Blazers to move up to the fifth seed in the Western Conference. And after the game, the Suns got on the team bus to head to the airport to get back to Phoenix for their game against the Sacramento Kings the next night. So now I'll get into what happened. Gugliotta, as of late, had been having trouble sleeping after games. So he wasn't getting to sleep until 3 or 4 in the morning. And he'd complained about that to his friend from high school, who told Googs about a supplement that he heard could help. Now, this supplement was sold under a bunch of different names: Reactive, Verve, Somatopro, Blue Nitro, Regenerize, Zen. I could go on. I have a list of all of them. Rejuvenite, Ultradiol, Enliven, Enforce, Liquid Gold, Soma Solutions. Is anybody still listening? Aminoflex, Dormir, Rescue. There are dozens more, but I feel like I've run that into the ground at this point. So all these were the same substance, which is something called furanone dihydro. And furanone dihydro is an organic compound known as a gamma butyrolactone, which is abbreviated as GBL. Now, according to the Canadian Institutes of Health Research, GBL consists of an aliphatic 5-member ring with 4 carbon atoms, 1 oxygen atom. I'm not reading all that. Essentially, what you need to know is that once it is ingested, the human body transforms the GBL into something called a GHB, which is an abbreviation for something even longer, but essentially it is the date rape drug. So these things, Somatopro and Verve and all those that were marketed to Gugliotta's friend from high school as a sleep supplement and was marketed more heavily as a strength enhancer and like recovery supplement, the latter of which made it semi-popular among like bodybuilders and wrestlers and people like that. That substance is actually something that like sleazy guys slip into women's drinks at parties. So that obviously is terrifying. But what's more terrifying is that it was perfectly legal for these companies to sell and market this ostensibly dangerous substance in a number of different ways with absolutely no evidence backing up their claims of it being like a natural herbal sleep supplement, because this substance, according to the Council for Responsible Nutrition, is found in trace amounts in some kinds of nuts and some kinds of melons. So it's, quote, natural. And it, you know, it being legal for all kinds of companies and manufacturers to sell things that aren't necessarily helpful is true more broadly. But for this specific compound, or whatever it is you want to call it, it was not banned because it wasn't the date rape drug. It was just something that sometimes turned into it under certain conditions in the human body. The GHB, the actual date rape drug itself, was banned by the FDA, thankfully, but its precursor, something that became it, was not. And these companies were allowed to do that thanks to DSHEA, which is the Dietary Supplement Health and Education Act of 1994, which weakened the FDA's ability to regulate supplements and allowed manufacturers to sell basically whatever they wanted without FDA approval if they were able to make it meet certain requirements, because dietary supplements were deemed to be a food instead of a drug. So the result was, as Gugliotta wrote once, these quote-unquote supplements didn't have to undergo the clinical trials and peer-reviewed research that proved them as safe or effective to get on the market like a prescription drug would need. And in order to be taken off of the market, they had to be proven unsafe, with numerous or at least several notable cases of severe bodily harm or death being causally linked to that supplement. And you can thank a bipartisan effort in the Senate for that absolutely brain-dead law. Orrin Hatch, Tom Harkin, President Clinton. Hope you all enjoyed your payday from, Big Herb on that one. So Gugliotta's friend, not knowing, you know, that this is dangerous, not having heard the news of date rapes and a handful of deaths at the hands of this particular supplement within the last year, not having heard about the FDA having reached out to the manufacturers and advising them to voluntarily recall the product, which they did not do, his friend bought a bottle online and had it sent to Gugliotta. The first time it worked, he fell asleep and slept well. So after the win over the Blazers, he took it again, hopped on the bus, and called his wife, Nikki. And while they were on the phone, Gugliotta said that he began to feel like there was electricity coursing through his body. And then he started to hear a humming noise, you know, start really faintly and then grow louder and louder. And then his face started twitching, and then he started to feel sick. And his wife said that Tom eventually, they were talking on the phone, and eventually he stopped making sense. He was just babbling, speaking nonsense, and all the while getting quieter and quieter. And then finally, Gugliotta says that with his last ounce of consciousness, what he was trying to do was end the call so that his wife wouldn't be scared. But he wound up dropping the phone, and then his head just kind of rolled back onto the seat. And the sound of Googs dropping his phone onto the floor of the bus and, you know, his abnormal posture is what alerted his teammates to what was going on. So Toby Bailey, who was a rookie guard on the Suns, he rushed over and saw that he was in distress and called for Robin Pound, who was the strength and conditioning coach. They start calling for an ambulance. They were still right outside of the Rose Garden in Portland. And so because of that, they were able to get EMTs onto the bus quickly, carry him out, load him into an ambulance. There was the Portland team doctor close by as well, thankfully. And as they're loading him into the ambulance, he begins to have a seizure. So he's, you know, foaming at the mouth and shaking, and eventually stops breathing while they're on the way to the hospital. Now, Gugliotta notes in this magazine article that he wrote, because he seized up and stopped breathing, he was super lucky that he took the supplement when and where he did. He took it right before getting on the bus instead of getting on the airplane. If they'd been on the plane and weren't able to hook him up to a respirator as quickly as they were able to, he would have died right there on the plane. If they'd been going, you know, to a different road game and he took it alone in his hotel room, he would have died in his hotel room. But because he was surrounded by his teammates and close to the EMTs, he lived. But another thing that helped him out was some quick thinking on the part of his wife. So he'd been on the phone with Nikki, and she heard the commotion that ensued and the calls for an ambulance. So when she heard all of that, she called her friend, who was Rex Chapman's wife. And Chapman and Gugliotta had been teammates both in Washington and now in Phoenix. So Chapman was on the team bus with Gugliotta. So then they're kind of playing, you know, that kids game telephone. Nikki Gugliotta calls Rex Chapman's wife and is like, tell Rex that Tom was taking the supplement. And then the wife called Rex and said, tell the trainers or the EMTs that, you know, this supplement that he was taking is going to be in his bag somewhere. So Rex gets the call. They rifle through Tom's bag and they find the supplement. And once he gets to the hospital, they're able to give him, I don't know if it's an antidote or, you know, something to counteract the effects and save his life. But it didn't end there. His road to recovery took a couple weeks. He was on the respirator for a few hours. He was completely unresponsive to any external stimulus. They had to perform multiple spinal taps to check him for meningitis, which he did not have. But those multiple spinal taps gave him a headache that persisted throughout his recovery. And that was actually the last thing that kept him out of games for the final stretch of his recovery. He had a splitting headache for like 12 days. And finally, he was cleared on December 30th of 1999, so 13 days after the event. And he returned to play on January 4th, 2000 against the Charlotte Hornets. And in the Arizona Republic article reporting that Gugliotta was cleared, I forget if he's a columnist or a reporter, because I'm not a journalist. I don't know the terminology that well. But Bob Young, who's the writer who reported on it, which in my mind, makes him a reporter, but maybe it was in a column. Nobody knows. But Young said that the furanone dihydro had, quote, street slang names such as water and liquid, which is, in my opinion, freak of the week worthy. So his first game back, Gugliotta said, was really rough. He was in a lot of pain. He missed all but one of his shots. He was super winded. You know, he was just out of shape, relatively speaking. So he only managed to play 16 minutes, although he did grab 10 rebounds in that time. And it really took him a while to round back into form, but he had a good February and was really turning it on in March until, unfortunately, he tore the ACL and the MCL in his left knee. And really after that, he was just never the same. He was 30 years old when he blew out his knee, so that definitely exacerbated his decline. He did return after 8 months and play parts of four more seasons in Phoenix, but his performance in that time was pretty lacking. He went from being like a 15-8 guy, 15 points, 8 rebounds on league average or better efficiency to 5-4 on below average shooting. His playing time was cut in half and, you know, he was just no longer a starting quality player after that. So that's unfortunate, but he was alive. That's what's important here. So Gugliotta said right when he returned to the court, quote, I'm hoping something good can come out of this other than my recovery. If anybody is even thinking about this stuff, furanone dihydro, there is no way the positives, if there even are any, can outweigh what can happen. And something good did come out of it. The FDA was able to directly link furanone dihydro to 19 cases of people who had either had a seizure or gone into a coma immediately after taking it. I believe that's all in the year 1999, so that is including Tom Gugliotta, as well as 6 deaths. And a 2002 Justice Department survey of emergency departments in 22 major U.S. cities turned up just over 11,000 ER visits with mentions of furanone dihydro from 1994 to 2000. And it's now been classified as a Schedule 1 controlled substance. And as of 2021, only 3 manufacturers have DEA clearance to produce it. And in order to purchase it, you have to have DEA clearance as well. Its use for human consumption has pretty much been regulated out. And now it's primarily used as an ingredient in tire and rim cleaner and other cleaning solutions. So 20 to 25 years ago, the stuff that you can pick up at AutoZone was going into people's mouths. So that is great. AutoZone, by the way, my former employer, do not work there. It absolutely sucks. But yeah, as I mentioned, Gugliotta's career was pretty unremarkable from that season forward because of his knee injury. He played in Phoenix, Utah, Boston, and Atlanta, had 12 career playoff games, but over $80 million in career earnings. And ultimately, he got to live past December 17th of 1999, so we are very happy about that. So with that, I am going to call it a night. Thank you very much for listening. I really appreciate it. I've gotten a lot of support and DMs from listeners lately that have been really nice. Lots of kind words over on TikTok where I continue to not miss. I'm posting bangers every day over there. At Backfired NBA Pod on TikTok, same at on Instagram and Twitter. At Logic Master with a 0 in place of the O is my own Twitter. Follow the socials if you'd like. If you don't want to, that's okay too. But DM me if you want. Had a lot of good conversations with listeners. Many are saying that I'm a rising star, a 30 under 30 candidate for excellence in podcasting and content creation. I won't name names or anything, but, you know, join the chorus of people singing my praises if you'd like. Anyway, that's it for me. Once again, greatly appreciate you, and we'll talk next week. Have a good one.
Baby, are you gonna be the one that saves me? And after all, you're my wonderwall.